This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Every medium is different. I can see it. I can feel it. I feel it. It's just more languages to learn, to understand. Because what I see isn't necessarily what comes in here. And when I was talking to him, I'm like, you can see, if you can have your hand up, I'm like, focus on my hand, and you can see against a white background. Here, but you'll see it's trying to get fuzzy, and that's just that's their energy coming in, and so it got caught on camera. But it was.
Could you see the fuzzy spot above her fingers there?
Yeah.
A digital anomaly. So it's not like you're seeing a face or an orb or something like that. We've had quite a few orb conversations as well. But here's the point. Jennifer has different filters than the rest of us. We all have filters. If you can bypass the filters, which I'm talking about tomorrow, if you can bypass the filters, you can access this information.
And I believe everybody has this. Everybody, I think eventually everybody's going to be able to see the other side. I think it's just a matter of time. And I feel like everyone, you know, everyone can talk to spirit. They just don't know if they can. Just again, bypassing the filters.
And these are just some of the books that Jennifer and I have done together. So over the past 8 years, having these conversations, I film them, record them, transcribe them, follow up. I follow up on the details, historical accuracy, those kinds of things. It's mind-bending, but we've been doing it for a while. I just wanted to mention this. They're called Backstage Pass to the Flip Side, and it's because while we were doing a session, Jennifer said, Tom Petty is here. And I went, I don't know Tom Petty. He had just passed away. I said, do you know Tom Petty? And she was like, no. I said, what are you doing here? And her answer was, he's saying, oh my gosh, you have no idea how hard it is to talk to you guys. There's a line around the block. And your friend Luana, I mentioned her earlier, she's our moderator on the other side. And he said, she's like the person with the clipboard at the VIP lounge. You can't get in unless you talk to her.
What?
So that's why I call them those books. But I mean, there he is. These are some of the people that Jennifer I've talked to over the past 8 years, including the right upper hand corner, J. Allen Hynek. His son is here. These are stories I would tell if Jennifer wasn't here. But I will tell you, Jimi Hendrix shows up quite a bit. There was a request for him today from Ron, by the way. And on the right corner, this is a mind-bending thing. You know who that is? Israel K., right? The guy who wrote or sang Over the Rainbow. So I was doing a session, guided meditation, with a Harvard alum. Not that Harvard matters, but she is. And I'm having this conversation with her, and I said, can we talk to your guide? And she said, I think it's the guy, Israel K., the guy who sang Over the Rainbow. And I said, what? Well, let's ask him. Are you really him, or are you just manifesting? Are you just projecting an image? She said, no, he's saying it's him. And I said, okay, let me ask you a question. Now, I'm a former variety music critic, so I know a lot about how music's made. And I knew the story of how that song came into existence. I didn't know why, but I knew the story. So I said, So is it true that you got up in the middle of the night to write that song? The woman said, he's saying, yes, it was a tribute to a friend of his. Now I knew that he got up in the middle of the night, went down to the studio, recorded it in one take. So I said, a tribute to who? And this woman in Boston on Zoom says, he's saying the word Gabby. I keep saying it. Gabby. My brain freezes. She says, he's saying Pahoony? Pahoony. Gabby Pahoony. I'm getting a chill now saying it. I said, is he saying Gabby Pahanui? She went, that's it. He said, Chi-hoo. He's saying, Chi-hoo. I said, what does chi who mean? She goes, I don't know. He's saying it. Chi who? The next day, I was teaching at Loyola, Marymount University fellow. One of my students on Zoom, you know, back in the pandemic, was in Hawaii. I said, can I ask you a question? Have you ever heard the term chi who? She goes, yeah, it's a slang. It means you got it. You look it up, chi who. It's Samoan. Hawaiians use it for like touchdown, you scored, right on. Chi who. All right, how are we doing so far? I want to know how you guys are doing. Are you guys cool? I mean, we're down 30. What are we missing? Because, you know, this is a workshop. I see Sherry raising her hand in the corner, my wife. Sherry, what are we not doing yet? Anything? We're good. Okay. My toughest critic. Go ahead, speak.
Sir, have we accessed our council?
Okay. I'll tell you what, before we get started, I'm going to give you a little guided meditation, all right? It'll take less than 5 minutes, maybe 10. All right? Very good. So, I have never done this in public before, but I have heard people do it in public, all right? By the way, on the YouTube website, MartiniProds or MartiniZone, where Jennifer and I have all our podcasts, there is a meditation, hypnotherapy, hypnosis session given by Dr. Helen Wamba back in the 1970s. And one of her clients that day made a recording and sent it to me. So I put it online so anyone for free can do a 2-hour hypnosis session with a professional clinical psychologist. All right? Her name is Dr. Helen Wamba. Just Google WAMBACH and my name, or Martini Zone, you'll find it. All right? Oh, all right. Here's our guided meditation. I call this my Beatles meditation. Why? Because of the song Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. Picture yourself in a boat on a river. This is the meditation I use throughout the book Divine Counsels. Each person started there. So I want you to picture yourself in a boat on a body of water. Doesn't matter if it's a river, could be the Atlantic, could be an ocean, could be a sea, but it is water. And I want you to imagine the boat, and it doesn't matter if it's small or big, or a paddle wheel, or something that you're familiar with, that's fine. If you've been in this boat, note, I know this boat, I don't know this boat. It's fine, one way or the other. Could be from this era, could be from another era. You can explore this later, in another meditation, you can say, where do I know this boat from? Is this my boat? And sometimes people do see boats that they remember owning in a previous lifetime. So let's just allow. We're in a boat on a body of water. We're not going anywhere. The boat's anchored. I don't want you guys going downstream. I don't want you going through rapids. I must say this also. I don't want you to think about anything negative. I'm going to put that suggestion in your mind. I don't want you to fear anything. At this moment, we're only going to look at wonderful, fun things that are good for you and that your guides want you to see. Let's do that. So now we're in this boat. Think about how many people could sit in the boat. A lot? A few? One? Two? Doesn't matter. Now look at the river. Are you in a clear water? Is it muddy water? Doesn't matter. Are we in sea? Make it calm. If the seas are rough, calm them down. Then look out at the shore. How far away is the shore? Is it far, far, or is it near? Just picture, what does the shore look like? Woods, trees, sand, doesn't matter. This is a happy place for you to be because it's the first thing that came to your mind. And now, I'm going to ask someone to sit across from you. Doesn't matter who that is. But I'm going to say that your guide, your teachers, your counsel, your classmates know what you're doing. They know what I'm doing to some degree. So if it's a guide, if that's who you'd like to talk to, invite your guide. Whatever that word means, bring your guide, have them sit across from you. Sometimes people see a light. If you're seeing a light, and maybe it's in the distance, ask the light to come forward. Ask it to be closer to you. Now imagine that you can turn the light into a person and ask the light, could you manifest as an individual because it makes it easier to converse? Try not to judge whoever you see. It could be a cartoon character. It could be somebody from a movie. It could be your grandfather, grandmother. It could be a famous individual. Try not to judge the weirdness of that. Just allow whoever needs to be here is here. And now it gets interesting. While they're sitting across from you, notice what they look like. Arms, legs. Are they wearing clothes? Hopefully. They don't want to scare you. But you ask them this one question. Can I ask you a question? That's your first question. Can I ask you something? They will nod, or they should nod. You gotta tell them. Look, you gotta nod, shrug, or shake your head. That shows that we can communicate. So please, ask them to nod. Have they all nodded? You good with that? All right, let's pretend they nodded. And what I like to say is if they don't nod, tell them, it's a game. And if you want to play this game with me, you gotta nod. You gotta give me permission to ask you a question. And the next question might be, whatever comes to mind, maybe you have a list of them. How am I doing? Sometimes I'll give you a thumbs up. Sometimes they give you the Italian wave of the hand, like, eh, that's a good. Whatever that thing is, they generally aren't going to give you negative because I ordered them not to. So here we are in the boat with your guide or teacher or friend or grandparent. It doesn't matter. If you can, reach over and hold their hands in your mind. I mean, your mind's eye, grab their hands. And notice, what does that feel like? Are they cold? Are they hot? Are they warm? If they're cold, what I ask people to do is ask them to warm them up. And that's a way to get a reaction, like asking them to nod. What we're doing is giving them the way to communicate. They're already having their reality. They're trying to figure, of course, they'll tell you they've tried to communicate with us many times, but we're so busy, we just don't focus. So give them the opportunity to say something. And it might be just a nod or a visual. And this is the next thing. Try to disassociate sound with communication. They're going to give you visuals first. And then from the visual, then you can go on to asking questions. So now I'm going to suggest, and this is a suggestion, that your guide or teacher or friend give us a trip to your counsel. And when I say that, try to picture, are we inside or outside? You can examine the journey, but the question is, are we inside or outside? Sometimes people say, we're outside, but it's like in space. So I'm standing in space, or I'm in space. Sometimes people say, we're outside. It's a garden. It's a beautiful forest. What I ask you to do is be observant. Look around. Look at the, if you're inside, look at the floor. Are there columns? Are there, what's it made out of? How high are the ceilings? Is there a light? Where's the light coming from? Don't judge whatever comes to mind. Just ask those questions. What is this place? If you're outside, take a close look. Are those living trees? Are there woods? Is there water? And if there is, you can go up to each item and put your hands on it and ask a question. am I creating this or are you creating this? Who's creating this? Is this for me or is this by me? Try not to judge whatever it comes up. It's fine. At this point, when someone sees a tree, I ask people, well, ask the tree a question. Put your arms around the tree. Maybe the tree can tell you something. That's where I got the answer from a tree that said, you know, humans are like insects. They're just more annoying. So in terms of if we're inside or outside, the next question I ask is how many people are here? And that might be any number. It might be three people. It might be a lot of people. It's the amount of people that you're supposed to see. Sometimes people see 12 chairs or 15 chairs, but there's only three people there. When you ask questions like, why are there only three people? Where is everybody? Is there a bigger, better, are they over Richard Dolan's up there? Where are they? And you can then get the answer from them. They'll say, often, you're not supposed to know these people yet. Eventually you will. And when you see people that are there, you go to the first person on the far left and you ask them simple questions. First question, and now when I say that, whatever that person is, male, female, light, doesn't matter. The first question is, can I ask you a question? Do I have your permission to ask you a question? And if they say yes, sometimes they say no, but I say yes, ask them, what do you represent on my council in a word? And allow whatever that word is or idea to come forth. You can ask them, how many councils are you on? You can ask them their opinion about what you're doing. Is this a good thing? Is this what I'm supposed to be doing? You can ask them about course corrections. How am I doing? What do I need to work on? Who am I here to help or heal? And they can put an image in your mind. Okay? And so now you can go down the row, one after the other. Who's the person to your left? And you keep, and if you have a pen, that helps, because you jot down what they represent. Because it's later on you're going to say to yourself, wow, I have all of these qualities that they represent that are from me. I should really focus on those. And then when you get to the end of the row, you thank them all. You appreciate it. And before you come home, you say, could you show me a place of healing? That's what I always ask, because it's a way to sort of rejuvenate. You don't just leave the council sort of on the high and dry. But you ask to show them, for them to show you a place of rejuvenation and energizing and healing. And something will come to mind. Sometimes it's inside, sometimes it's outside. Don't judge it. Just go to that space, deep breaths, enjoy the feeling of being healed. And carry the memory of that frequency back into your life, because it can be with you whenever you want to access it. And then I like to say, now we're back in the boat. And we're sitting in the boat. And now you look over to your left, and you're like, oh my gosh, there's Rich and Jennifer on a stage. What a weird place to be. All right, and that's it. That was exactly 15 minutes. Is that it? Okay. You got anybody any questions about that? Go ahead.
Still have names?
Say it. Yeah, no, come on up, sure. Tim has got the white paper, just fling it up here. Yep, that's the whole idea about, there you go, thanks, man. Oh, sorry. Tim is right here. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So you mentioned all these amazing, famous people. You mentioned Genghis Khan. What did he have to say?
Well, I would say he had a lot to say. It was fascinating. And literally, if you go online and you go to the Hacking the Afterlife and just Google it, it's about an hour, I think it's a half an hour conversation. Because, look, I know a little bit about history, enough to go, where's your body? Yeah. Now, people in the audience don't realize that where Genghis Khan is buried is a huge historical conundrum. Nobody knows, but I know, because he told us. Jennifer wasn't aware that that was an issue. But I saw, I asked, where's your body? What happened? What happened to you? I'll just say this. He said that in the last years of his life, he was traumatized by paranoia. Everyone was going to kill him. That he had some affliction, a mental affliction that wouldn't allow him to sleep. And so he didn't sleep for the last, I think he said, 7 years of his life. So he basically was this paranoid freak walking around killing anybody who crossed him. I mean, it's Game of Thrones kind of stuff. But ultimately, you know, he's okay now, you see? He's had many lifetimes since, but not like as a marauding guy. So you wonder, like, why did he choose that one? All right, anyway, thank you. Am I picking? I am, wait a minute, magical. Can we cue the music?
Richard, pick it. Okay, Eddie R. What question would you have?
Put the mic up to
what question would you have?
Do you want to talk to Eddie R, or do you have a question for Eddie R, or does Eddie R have a question?
I'm asking you if you have a question, Eddie R.
Yes.
Yes, go ahead.
Do I have a question?
Tim, you want to hand in the mic? Then we can hear it. I'm sorry. Thank you, Tim. Working on our
What can you say about what's on the other side?
Tim, bring it back. Thanks, man.
Or just want to hold on to it, if you don't mind. Thank you, Tim. I'm sorry. What do you want to say about what's on the other side? So the question has come up in how many sessions have I filmed? 200. And people are either under hypnosis or doing guided meditation or via a talented medium. Where are you? That's the question. And they always answer the same. They use the same word, which when I first heard it, I thought, well, that's weird. What does that mean? I'm home. When the first person said it, I thought, is she talking about the lifetime she just remembered in Warsaw? Or is she talking about her life as this person, like grew up in Schenectady? No, she meant home, where we came from. And it's not all of us. We don't all come from the same place. We all come from different places, clearly. But we know what home is. And when you use that word home, what does it mean? A place of warmth, a place of unconditional love, a place that we come from. And that's what people report. And so when you're doing these guided meditations, perfect question to ask. What's it like on the flip side? Is it home? You may get a different answer. It's possible. Try not to judge it. Just, you know, allow it. What does that mean? What's home? What's home for me? I mean, we all have a different idea of home. Okay. Thank you. Was that an answer to your question? Sort of.
Just, I have yet to see hell, just for the record. It's you know, a lot of people want to know if there's a heaven or if there's a hell. And everything that I've ever seen is heaven and hell resides within you. It's not anything that's outside of you, if that makes sense, if that helps as well.
Okay. Cool.
Carol C.
Hi.
Tim, do you mind? Oh, we stole your mic, Eddie. Oh, new batteries.
Yeah.
Well, go ahead, Carol. Do you mind standing up and speaking?
Okay. Is it as easy? Is it as easy for me to talk to Albert as I think it is? He, by the way, is on the flip side.
Is it as easy to talk as we're talking now to talk to him?
Is that what I'm material, he is not material. But we talk. Is it really as easy as that?
Yes, it's that easy. Mm-hmm.
I would say, and from Jennifer's point of view, it's like a dream. And you know how easy it is to talk in a dream, right? And so it's as easy as that is. And it's the same because it's a mental construct of telepathy.
Conversation.
yeah, conversation.
Right. I'm material, he's not.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
You have to just look, you have, like, the biggest help from Richard is him telling me, don't judge it. Just allow it to come through. Because I want to judge it. When I saw it, it was gone, I'm like, that's not somebody I want to talk to. You know, he's like, don't judge it. Just go with it, you know? Everyone speaks differently. There's some spirits that, you know, don't talk as much. Well, they didn't talk that much here either. You know, they leave with their personalities as well. So you have to understand that too. Yeah.
However, they do have a better view.
Yes.
So you can ask them about their view, you see? Now, this question comes up a lot where people want to ask, what's going to happen to me, you know, etc. If they told you, it would disrupt the whole circus that you've created so that you would get to learn these lessons. They'd be cheating. And then it would be like taking a class and, you know, getting, like, can I get the answer to the quiz before I take the quiz? Which would be me. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Voila.
Kimberly. Kimberly P. Hi. Hello.
I just formulated my question. How I have a tremendous amount of family on the other side.
Okay.
My question is, I do feel them, and I do feel them very close at times, especially when my mind goes to them. When I'm thinking about them, then yes. Suddenly they're there. Or, and how can we in the living world be of service to them? What is it that we can do for them while they're over there? We're existing in oneness, but they're in this other either right. space. They're coming to us because they want to translate messages or
they want to help us.
They want to help us, but right. how can we be a bridge for them and make that go both ways?
I think the best, it's a great question. From my experience of talking to thousands on the other side or giving thousands of readings, it's occurred to me that the majority of them want us to love. They want us to be in love. They want us to love ourselves. They want us, I mean, the best way to honor them is to love yourself. Because if you love yourself, it's an easier connection. If you love yourself, you're able to love others. You're able to have compassion for others. And I feel like in my experience, everybody else's experiences are different, but I think honor, what's the best way to honor them? What would be that? What does that look like for you? And each person is different. But I think that's really the big thing. You're welcome.
So also, I just want to, if you have a question for Jennifer to talk to somebody off planet.
Or about yourself. You have a health question. Like if you say, hey, can you do a medical check-in? People come to me for that. Or if even anybody alive, people come to me wanting to know about their kids or wanting to know about their husband and their boyfriend.
So you understand? I mean, it's fine to ask me a question or about the topic, but you have a cell phone to the afterlife sitting right here. You can pick anyone, their first name.
I just need their first name for the sake of time.
I know it sounds weird, but anyone.
Yeah.
All right, so here you go.
Richard D.
Richard D? Oh, he escaped. All right, that's all right. All right, never mind. Here you go.
Lisa H.
Liza H.
Liza H, sorry.
Can I have more time to think of a question?
Sure. Okay. Put the box in your lap. Okay. Eeny, meeny, miny.
Oh, I think that's Jan.
I think that's Jan S. Or Jam S.
Yes.
There you go.
Hi. Thank you. Jennifer. Yes. I would like to know if Alan has a message for me.
And who is she? So say the name again. And
Alan.
Alan? And who is Alan to you for the sake of time?
My father.
Your father. Okay. Give me a second. And what's your first name? I'm sorry. Jan?
Jan.
Jan. Thank you. Okay. Well, he's showing me how busy you are. He He's shown me that you're very busy. Hold on.
Is anything business related? Does he have any suggestions, business wise?
Feels like you need to delegate. Like you need to, that's what it, and it's just interpretation. I feel like you have to delegate more of your work or something like
and
that.
And so what Jennifer and I do is I now interrupt her and say, who greeted you on the other side when you crossed? And what does he say?
He has his own family, his father.
His father is who greeted him on the other side. Was that a happy reunion or was that to start?
It feels confusing to me.
It was confusing to him. And why was it confusing? Did you not know where you were, or was it? Did you guys depart?
I feel like they were. They might have not. I don't know how much they talked while they were alive.
So he's saying they didn't talk as much when they were on the planet. So having his father greet him on the other side was disconcerting at first.
At first.
But how are you doing now?
I think he helps. Is that, did he help his dad pass?
Yes.
Yeah. So he was showing me that it was just whenever he's like, but I helped my father pass, so it was great when I did. I was confused. I knew my confusion came because I knew I was gone by seeing my dad. And so that's where I got old.
Is there one thing that you want to say to your daughter that she would understand and nobody else in this audience would? Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm just talking to him. Is there something that he wants to say to his daughter that only she would understand, but maybe nobody here would? Just something very specific. Could be a detail, something weird.
It has to do with food.
Has to do with food. I try to say to Jennifer, don't judge what you're getting. What's the food? What kind of food?
I don't know. There's just something about eating more.
Says you need to eat more. So whatever that means to you,
no,
you see, it won't
do
well.
Has
to do with food. Maybe he's eating better. You know, that's always a little bit different. Anyway, this
and even though the watch doesn't work, there's something about a watch that was handed down that doesn't work, correct?
There's some watch that you have that of his that doesn't work.
Oh, I don't know. I better check.
Okay. I mean, I had a conversation, guided meditation with this woman who we were going over her father, and in her mind's eye, she could see him wearing a Timex. And she went, he didn't own a Timex. I said, well, you're seeing it. And so then she went back to her apartment and wrote to her brother, and the brother sent her a photograph of dad wearing his Timex that she wasn't aware of. So sometimes they give you a detail that you're going to find later on, you see? You'll find the watch, the broken watch that doesn't work. It might be next week.
Thank you, Jen.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's what we do. That's our thing. Thank you.
Bridget A. Hi, Bridget.
Sorry, I'm picking up. Maybe I'll shuffle a little better.
Literally just said I want you to pick my car.
My father passed a few years ago.
Okay.
And
I'm sorry.
Thank you. I was there at his passing.
Okay.
And it was really intense. And I felt like I messed up.
Okay.
Put your mic.
I don't feel that you. So what he showed me, it was just his body that you were watching. That he had already left. And so. He's saying that something happened a couple hours prior to that, but he was gone for like a day and a half, it feels like. He was in and out of consciousness, he says. And he says that you did mess up. It had to do with the medicine?
Yeah.
Right? That you're talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. He's saying that's not your fault. And he's saying that he knows that you were holding his hand. He knows that you told him it was okay to go. And he's saying... Give me 1 second. Give me his name.
Rock.
Rock. Hold on. It's challenging because I can hear the other room. It's challenging. I'm trying to block that room. Let's see. Hold on. Rock.
What other room? Just
right.
Kidding.
Right. We're in the spaceship. You didn't mess up at all.
And did he have some type of, I felt like he had some type of reaction towards something, so like medicine too.
No, he was in hospice, so it was the medicine for pain, and he was at peace, so I just decided not to do it. Because he was fine at home, but anyway.
You didn't mess up. He said that it was, he said you kept him alive a lot longer than he probably should have been kept alive. You were fine.
Is there anything he wants to say to Bridget?
Please don't worry. He just, by you being afraid that you did, it's keeping you away from him, even though he's there because of your grief. And so by you just knowing that you did everything right, it will allow him to come through clearer for you. You have nothing to be like fearful of. Does that make sense?
It does. I have one other thing that I asked. The other day, like last week, I was literally waking up and somebody said my name, like it was audible, but I don't know who that was.
Feels like a grandmother. Feels like a grandmother that said your name.
Cool.
Yeah.
Hi, Grandma.
I know.
All right, very good. I think that was lovely. Thank you so much for that. I just want to say one thing about grief. When I was first started working with Jennifer, her dad had passed. And so one day we were having a session where I was, you know, filming and talking to her, and I saw tears coming to her eyes, and I just knew he had entered the space without asking. And I said, so let's ask your dad, is there anything he can tell us to help people with grief? And she said, he says, try to move grief to nostalgia. And I said, what does that mean? And Jennifer looked at me and went, I don't know. He said it. I said, well, we can ask him. So she asked him, and he said, grief is mostly sad memories. Nostalgia is both sad and happier memories. And when you can move grief to nostalgia, you begin the healing process. Easily the most profound thing I've heard about the topic. And now?
Amanda J. C.
Hi. So Jennifer, would you mind asking any of the or the other 18 beings that the podcast that you talk with about why does sometimes a departed loved one show up when experiences or abductees have an experience? Either they're abducted or they have some kind of experience with an extraterrestrial, but then they'll often see a departed loved one with them at the time. And I'm just curious about that because it's happened a lot. So,
okay. So if I hear this correctly.
You want me to take that question? So, I mean, the question is, why is it some abductees see family members in their, is it the memory of what happened or when they're recounting what happened?
When they were, because some of them remember the experience, and some of them have regression, hypnotic regression.
Yeah.
And at the time, they remember experiencing not just the abduction.
Sure, but seeing their family members.
Also, usually just one family member. And I was just curious about that because it's.
Well, if I may, I did a guided meditation with Simon Bowen on his podcast about the afterlife. He's an Oxford fellow. And I didn't know he had been abducted as a child, but we were just exploring memories. And suddenly he was talking about being abducted. And so, just like I normally do, I said, well, can you freeze frame the memory so there's no emotion associated with it, no fear? He could. And I said, so let's address these people that are molesting you. That's not what I put it, but, you know, abducting him. And he said, this is weird. They're saying yes. And so I said, are you tourists? What are you doing here? Are you tourists? Are you just driving by? And they said, no, we're not. And I said, so why is it? And there was a group of people that were all had been abducted. And I said, so what's the point of this? And the
person I was talking to said, have you ever donated blood to the Red Cross? I said, yeah. He said, that's what these people are doing. They're donating genetic material to people off planet that need their help. And I said, why would they agree to that? He said, because they agreed to it before they incarnated on Earth. We know them from other planets, and they agreed to this beforehand. Very unusual way to put it. When Jennifer and I had a conversation with Stephen Hawking after he passed, we were asking him, I'm asking him, you know, have you been to visit a black hole? What's that about? What was your story? Why were you in a wheelchair? I mean, amazing things that he said, including punchline to a joke that Hank Azaria told on the Colbert Show. I don't know how he could know the punchline to the thing that I had seen, and he told it to Jennifer, and she told it to me. The man has no sense of time. That was the joke. But I said, how is it that, you know, people, have you seen an alien? Because he wrote about how that might be a fear. And he said, we're all aliens because we choose to incarnate on the planet from elsewhere. So if you allow that for a second, I mean, Daniel frankly sort of mentioned it yesterday, that we're all spirits, we're all lights. So if you see a loved one hanging out with somebody that you don't normally recognize, instead of assuming fear, assume there's a reason for it. Oh, I wonder if they know each other. Have you guys met? You see? You can ask questions about it. Okay.
I also felt like that if you see a loved one there, that they're there to let you know that it's okay, that you're safe. That was my first thing. Yeah. Okay. So.
Don't forget, Liza.
Liza, have you formulated it yet?
Sure.
Okay. Hi.
Mine's more technical.
Hold on a second. Yeah, Tim's coming. Thank you, Tim.
So, this is more of a technical question. So, I'm curious because you said when you talked to Genghis Khan, he talked about other lifetimes.
Yeah.
But then you're also talking about some people who are staying at their home. So how does that work?
I'm sorry, what was that last sentence word?
So I think of your soul as, or the soul as an ocean, and think of each wave being a different lifetime, but happening at the same time. And then it goes back to the soul. You're able to keep who you are, but you have the collective of you with you when you're over there, which to me, in what I've seen, I feel like that's when you feel like you're home. That's what home means. So you have, even though you came as Genghis Khan.
No, go ahead. Finish. No, I was going to, this was Jennifer Rango on the podcast.
Does that make sense to you? So he can be Genghis Khan, but he's home. He's never going to feel home, but I don't think.
Well, just based on the research of the data and what I've been researching for the past 15 years, people say the same things, that we exist prior to incarnation. We're light, we're energy, whatever you want to call it, we're photons of energy. We have you ever seen the film Soul by Pixar? They have little souls running around, and there's cherries that sort of take care of like classes of children. That is how it's described. And by the way, that movie was inspired by one of the people who founded Pixar who died, and his name is throughout the film. And then we've talked to Joe Ranft, and he's told us that he inspired the movie. But the idea of soul, I think, is a fantastic concept, but it's much better suited for food or music, soul food of the heart. But when we talk about conscious energy, it seems more appropriate because we're this energy. And when we come here, when we incarnate, we only bring about 20 to 40%. That's the average. Remember I said Paul Tracy's father had 10% of his conscious energy still here? So 90% was already home. In general, what people will say under hypnosis,
or asking them, or cell phone to the flip side, they brought a certain percentage, 30%, 40%, whatever that is. So a portion is always back home, including Genghis Khan. So even while he's on the planet being a nasty fella, there's a higher self that's back there going, really? Is that what you're doing? That's not what we planned. Why can't I think? I can't sleep. Whatever that is. Once you get off stage, the conscious energy that was on stage goes back home and reconnects. This is the filtering part, which is the offstage portion understands everything that we're doing, why we planned it, recognizes everybody in our play. The onstage portion, like an actor, like a good actor, everything's new. They don't see, recognize anything. Everything is happening. Huh, that's a weird coincidence. Not aware that they had planned that three lifetimes ago to make sure that they connected with that person again. You see? So it's that once we start to use the word soul, there's also the affiliations we have, religious affiliations, and it becomes amorphous. And I try to use conscious energy, but the idea is, you know, is that more appropriate? I don't know. And it's whatever, you know, someone feels and connects to, I think that's the most important thing. But in general, to answer your question, everyone's this way. There was a Genghis had a lifetime before he was Genghis Khan. You know, the 1200s, that's not that long ago. People say 25 iris, I'm pointing to you, people, because I felt iris under hypnosis. People say 25 years on Earth feels like 5 or 10 minutes back home. Do the math. Hey, buddy, 2,500. Oh, he told me he's going to do that. I said, just come to the door and I will let you in because you wave and say hi, Richard. That's brilliant. Love that. All right, go ahead. Next.
By the way, Iris is one of the best astrologers you'll ever meet. Mike Kowarowski. Hi, Mike.
Hello.
Hello.
Better known as the brain.
All right.
I had a brother who passed, his name was Ken, and he came to me in a dream about 2 or 3 months later, and he promised that he would take care and set it up for me and my buddy Nick on the other side. And I said, great, we pass over, take care of it. So, two-part question. What does he mean by take care of us? And the second part, I asked him to send a signal, kind of like a blue orb in the room, to signify that he's okay, and that dream was really him, and not me imagining it in the dream.
He said there was somebody else in that dream as well. So he was there, but he also said that there was somebody else. Give me a second. And give, what's his name?
Ken.
So what he means by that is they get to recreate whatever they want over there. And I feel like he says he's going to take care of you over there. He's going to greet you. He's going to greet you guys when you cross over. He's also going to make sure you have a nice place to go to. A soft landing is what I'm getting. And he says that he's come to you another time in a dream as well. And he says, I think because you took care of him, he's going to take care of you. That was his way of saying thank you. Does that make sense to you?
Can I ask Ted a question? Go ahead.
What about the blue orb?
Oh, the blue orb.
Can he send, can he, is it possible for him to send that from his dimension into mine so I can see that and know that it's all real?
It is definitely possible. But you have to let go of the filters that keep it. Like, sometimes it's not going to be blue. Sometimes it's going to be a little bit a different color.
Well, right. That's not going to be anything.
Okay.
Like, any
okay.
kind of orb thing.
Yeah.
Great.
Do you have a ring camera?
You'll get it.
Do you have a ring camera?
Pardon?
Do you have one of those ring cameras where they film everything?
No. But well, I'm
tell
really
you, do me a favor. Go to our website, MartiniZone. Look up the ring camera footage. A woman reached out to us. Her husband had passed away, and she, her camera recorded all these orbs. And so I gathered 11 minutes of it from all over the world of people reporting their loved ones coming back as orbs. But those digital cameras can pick it up easier than your eye can. However, Jennifer and I were doing a podcast. We were talking about orbs in the podcast. And while we were talking, one flew behind her head, around in a circle, and then zipped off. And she couldn't see it because she was in the room. But I could see it on the camera. So my point is, start using a camera. Film stuff in your house when you're talking to Ted or even around a photograph of him. Just have a conversation with him. Ted, what's up? What are you doing? Who greeted Ted on the other side? That's the question I want to ask. Who greeted Ted?
I'm pretty good with spirits. And like when I go to sleep at nighttime, a lot of times I'll sense and feel and actually see spirits. That's why I think I sleep with
one of those universe lights where they put the universe up above my husband. Thank goodness he's okay with it. But so that way I only see the lights because it's so thick at night when I go to sleep that you can feel it. And I don't mind it, but it just takes me a little bit longer to go to sleep. So when I just have the lights up on my ceiling, it makes it to where all I see are the lights.
I sleep with my light on because if it's off, it's too many spirit entities in there.
It's all right. Pretty nice.
Turn that camera on. All right.
Debbie D. Thank you, by the way. Debbie D.
Want to hand Micah, Tim, to Debbie D. Thank you, Tim.
Jennifer, I'm wondering if you can key into whomever might come through for me. Specifically, I want to know, I feel like I've had very, for me, unprecedented and surprising and wonderful experiences in shamanism as well as like some massive opportunities. I can tell you my sense about it. Like I really feel like there's extraterrestrials working on my behalf.
Yeah.
And I just want to know more.
Have you met your guide? No. Okay, let's add. No, I was going to ask. Go ahead.
Does Debbie's guide want to stop by? And that's the question. And then does anybody come to mind?
So before you even said ETs, I felt like it was going to be something else, not just a normal, like your loved ones being around you as far as your guides are concerned. And then I saw Mont Durga, Mont Durga too. But I, with
you. Do you mind if we talk to Mont Durga? Would you hand me the mic?
I have
no idea who that is.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know what? We talked about this on the podcast the other day, and
I think this will help.
Let me finish that one.
But go ahead, please.
You've seen the same reoccurring entity, correct?
Different ones.
Just different ones? Although, obviously, it'd be different. She hasn't seen the same one. But, and is there anything with Mother Mary, too?
Huge.
Because that's all I see. Wow. So when we started talking, Mother Mary's coming through, but I also felt some other ones. But that energy of Mother Mary is also the same as Mont Durga too, for things that I've seen.
Okay, very good.
But,
but
Mother Mary, you have a really strong connection to her. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that she's there to guide you. Mm. So, and I feel like you've written about it as well, or you should, right?
Definitely, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just wanted to say that when she just mentioned that Mother Mary energy, and I'm sure you've heard this before, there are certain avatars that are out there that represent like a profound energy, love, unconditional love. One of the first times I talked to Jennifer, she said, I'm seeing Jesus in the room. And I'm thinking to myself, really? How do you know it's him? I mean, the hair? Is he wearing a name tag? Is it the robe? Like what? I've subsequently learned 15% of all NDEs, people see Jesus, whether they believe in him or not. So in this case, I thought, oh, this is interesting. I had never asked an avatar a question before. I said, could he come closer? And as he came closer to Jennifer, she started to weep and her face turned beet red. and she couldn't breathe. And I'm thinking to myself, as a film director, I've seen a lot of people cry on camera. Never saw anybody's cheeks turn beet red. Because it's a non-thinkable thing, you know, physical. So I asked him a question, can I ask you a question? And she said, he says yes. And I said, what are you doing? Why is it when people see you, they get all choked up, they can't breathe? What's the matter with you? And I asked it that way to see if she was going to challenge that concept. She said, he's saying that when he chose this lifetime, she's getting a chill, he brought more consciousness. He said he brought more of source, brought more of source with him to the lifetime. And when people get close to him, they feel that unconditional love. And I said, jaded Hollywood guy that I am, not so much with the Romans. You know, the logic is if he's saying that in my lifetime I had so much more, well, some people didn't see it. But the weird thing is Jennifer said, I don't know what you just said, but he's laughing. That construct just blew my mind, the idea that I could ask him a question, get a response, and he would laugh. I would say the last time I did a guided meditation where somebody saw him in the room, I said, you know, same thing. Oh my God, I feel this incredible unconditional love. And I always ask, can he change into something more conducive to conversation? Because, you know, if you're seeing a guy, you know, on a rope and a thing, you know, it's hard to ask how you doing. But he always changes into the same outfit. Every time I ask that question, no matter who I'm talking to, jeans and a t-shirt. And I even said, like, you know, dude, do you have a limited wardrobe? So I said to this woman, do you see anything on his shirt? And she looked carefully and then she started to laugh. And I said, I just asked, I don't know what came to my mind. Look at his shirt, what does it say? She said, it says the Grateful Dead. So that idea of Mother Mary, I mean, we don't have time to bring Ma Durga to our conversation. Sherry, you raised your hand. What? Okay. Oh, one more? Okay, she's nodding. Okay, go ahead, pull it out. My wife, who's a little bit of a medium, is now telling me physically. Go ahead. One more.
Shay.
Right here.
Here you go. Oh, go ahead. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim, for doing
that. My question is, any guidance from my loved ones or spiritual guides from the other side? Just any general guidance.
First name?
My name is Shay.
No, but the person you want to ask guidance from?
It could be any of my guides or my father who passed back in.
First name?
His first name is Richard.
So, have you had a little bit of a bumpy road?
A little bit.
Okay. It feels like you have a transition of trying to figure out what you're going to do. And that could be with work or what you want to do within it. Because I actually feel like you can do your work with like a sleep. And so, sometimes people, when you get bored or when you feel that way, it's that point of contention where you feel like you're missing something or you want to do more, you're going to do more. Like if you're, so the guidance that I'm getting for you is things are going to change. They feel like they already have. And you put things, you're very, it feels like goal oriented, correct?
Yes.
Like you have things that are set that you're going to do. Just do something, they're just saying, don't think about the big picture. Just do something every single day that leads towards it. Because yeah, I feel there's a, it's a little bit overwhelming. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
But you're on the right path. That's the message to you. You're on the right path. You set your goals, it's just been a little bit bumpy. Try to lose the way you think you're gonna get there. And that will allow more to come in. Okay.
All right. They're telling us to wrap it up. Thank you so much. Let's hear it for Jennifer. Thank you. We've never done this before. Thank you so much for bringing that next.
to Tim for Sarah. Thank you for Tim for doing the microphone. And just as a way of saying goodbye and hello, this is very simple for you to do. Just do the guided meditation. Invite people to come and talk to you. Do it more than once. Go to a park, go to a garden, go to your favorite restaurant. Doesn't matter. And just ask them to come forward and give you guidance and try to write down whatever it is. And let us know, by the way, let us know how it goes. Please sign on to the podcast. Thank you.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on gaia.com via Amazon Prime.